Good morning. Welcome to worship at Grace Lutheran in Visalia, California. Today is the 27th of September already, the 17th Sunday after Pentecost. We thank you today for receiving us into your home, and we pray God's richest blessings on your worship. Just a reminder, we are at this point offering outdoor services Sunday morning, a single service at 9 o'clock on campus. We are, though, as you can see, still right here online, and we are thankful to be able to do that here with you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the Word, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Old Testament reading for the 17th Sunday after Pentecost comes to us from Ezekiel chapter 18, selected verses. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you people mean by quoting this proverb about the land of Israel? The fathers eat sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, you will no longer quote this proverb in Israel. For every living soul belongs to me, the father as well as the son. Both alike belong to me. The soul who sins is the soul who will die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. Hear, O house of Israel, is my way unjust? Is it not your ways that are unjust? If a righteous man turns from his righteousness and commits sin, he will die for it. Because of the sin he has committed, he will die. But if a wicked man turns away from the wickedness he has committed and does what is just and right, he will save his life. Because he considers all the offenses he has committed and turns away from them, he will surely live. He will not die. Yet the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord is not just. Are my ways unjust, O house of Israel? Is it not your ways that are unjust? Therefore, O house of Israel, I will judge you, each one according to his ways, declares the sovereign Lord. Repent, turn away from all your offenses, then sin will not be your downfall. Rid yourselves of all the offenses you have committed, and get a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, O house of Israel? For I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the sovereign Lord. Repent and live. Here ends the Old Testament. Today's epistle, Philippians chapter 2, selected verses. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Do everything without complaining or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault, in a crooked and depraved generation, in which you shine like stars in the universe as you hold out the word of life, in order that I may boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor for nothing. But even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you. So you too should be glad and rejoice with me. Here ends the epistle. The Holy Gospel, according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. By what authority are you doing these things? They asked. And who gave you this authority? Jesus replied, I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from men? They discussed it among themselves and said, if we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say from men, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Share with you just a couple of verses from Philippians chapter 2. Do everything without complaining or arguing, so that you may be blameless and pure children of God without fault in a crooked and depraved generation, in which you shine like stars in the universe, as you hold out the word of life. That's the word of our Lord, our title, our theme that grows out of that. Light shines brightest in the darkest places. Many years ago, a fellow pastor shared a story about one of his people coming to him and saying how difficult things had been at work for her lately. She was so down because of how hopeless she saw the situation to be. The situation was so very dark. And after she had shared this, her pastor said to her, "Have you ever thought about how the Lord might have you there on purpose?" And she said, "What do you mean, Pastor?" And that's when he said, "Sometimes light shines the brightest in the darkest places." That pastor, a friend of mine, had today's verses in mind. His point was that she had opportunity to shine in a very dark place, right there where she worked, in the midst of a crooked and depraved generation. She had opportunity to hold out the word of life to those in desperate need of it. How about you? How about you? Have you ever found yourself in a really dark place? Just recently, I spoke with a very young pastor, and he was heartbroken. Those were the words he used, heartbroken over the fact that he was not allowed to be in person with one of his members on her deathbed. He was heartbroken too that only one of her family members was able to be with her in person then and there. I know some of you have been in similar dark places, heartbroken, frustrated, maybe angry over not being allowed to be with loved ones in person for well over 6 months now. I had a conversation with a friend the other day, and he's part of a church and school in another part of the state. They began online only, but now have gotten to that light at the end of the tunnel, so to speak. They've just gotten a waiver to reopen in person, and the teachers are really happy to be back in person with the students. But you know what they found out on that first day? Only 88% of the families were comfortable risking their children out and about in these crazy times. So guess what? Extra effort, extra energy, along with extra expense has been necessary in order to minister to everybody. I know some are experiencing health challenges, the facing of things very unpleasant to face, the possibility of things disheartening to consider, maybe life-altering, maybe even life-threatening. It can be pretty dark out there. Some have lost jobs. Some have experienced reduction in hours and pay. Some have had their lives disrupted by the threat of fire. Many have had home and belongings destroyed. Some are mourning the loss of life. It can be pretty dark out there, and we've really only just scratched the surface, right? Paul uses some very strong language today in the epistle when he speaks of the darkness of that particular generation. The New International Version translates it crooked and depraved. The ESV, the English Standard Version, says crooked and twisted. One commentator in a literal translation says warped and twisted. And we found over the years, haven't we, and over the months and weeks and days, that God's Word is always relevant. We today still live in a crooked and depraved generation, a crooked and twisted generation, a warped and twisted generation. And I know I run the risk right now of being accused of getting political because some see and attempt to make everything in life political. But I'm still going to ask, not judge, but ask what I consider to be some common sense questions. If certain lives really matter, why is it that most of the last 100-plus nights of rioting and looting have destroyed so many black businesses and neighborhoods? If certain lives really matter, why is it that black-on-black shootings in major cities across our nation are virtually ignored? If certain lives matter, why is it that so many black babies' lives are ended by abortion? And if life itself really matters, why is it that over 62 million babies' lives have been taken since the Roe v. Wade decision? The fact is, it's pretty dark out there amidst a crooked and depraved generation, a crooked and twisted generation, a warped and twisted generation. And you know, dear people of God at Grace, I know that you know that. I also know that you didn't come to church today to hear bad news. You didn't come out or maybe tune in today to fall further into a dark, bottomless pit. And so, as that pastor once asked, have you ever thought about how the Lord might have you right where you are on purpose. What I mean is this: light shines brightest in the darkest places. The Apostle Paul encourages us today the same way he did the Philippian congregation a couple thousand years ago. He says, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing, he says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others as better than yourselves. Each of you should look not to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. And then, because he knows this does not come naturally to us as fallen people in a fallen world, he adds, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. And then he points directly to Jesus. God himself in the flesh, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. But he couldn't be held by death, and God exalted him. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is our Lord. And in this generation too, Jesus is the light of the world. Just exactly as he said a couple thousand years ago, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And in another place, he adds, I have come into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. Remember that old man, Simeon, long ago, seeing and taking baby Jesus into his arms in the temple? You remember his prayer of praise? I know you do, because it's your prayer of praise each time that you receive Jesus' body and blood at his supper. You probably even know it by memory, maybe even in the old King James English. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people. A light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of thy people Israel. Jesus' salvation, his truth, his grace is light to and for us. We receive it and we reflect it. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, Jesus actually says of us, his people, You are the light of the world. And then he adds a great picture saying, a city set on a hill cannot be hidden. I think it was close to a year ago, either late fall or early winter, I was still serving over at Zion in Tarabella, and I was heading that direction from Paso Robles early one morning. It was still very dark, it was cold, and it was very, very clear. I got to the peak of that last grade above the Central Valley before dropping into it, and way, way off in the distance, I could see a light on a hill. Actually, you know it was a mountain. On the other side of the valley and a little ways to the north, from where I was, my guess is it had to be close to 90, maybe even 100 miles away. And I could see that one single light. Now, imagine a whole city, a whole congregation set on a hill, all sorts of light, there as a beacon, as if signaling to others, need out of the throes of darkness? Come, join us here. And Paul reminds us that lit up by our Lord Jesus, having received His light, the way we reflect His light best is to do everything without complaining or arguing, that we be blameless and pure children of God without fault. In other words, forgiven and forgiving. That's how we best reflect and direct that light of Jesus to others. Yes, in the mess of this generation, we shine like stars in the universe, holding out the word of life. When I was preparing to leave our home over in Paso in the wee hours of Saturday morning, the half moon was in the west and it was just settling behind the hills. It was still a little bit red, a little bit of smoke color, but it was quite clear outside. And because the moon was setting and it was getting darker, I decided to look up into the sky. And up there, just shining away, all those stars in the universe, giving glory to God for me to see when I look up. Wow, what a sight that was. And I got to thinking about our title, our theme, Light Shines Brightest in the Darkest Places. And I got to thinking, too, of Paul's wording, at least in the New International Version, where he says, shine like stars in the universe. And my thinking went kind of like this. The stars are way up there, put in place by God at creation for His glory. And you know what? They do their thing whether or not anyone is looking. They just do according to what they are. They don't force you to notice them. They just twinkle away all the time. And when you happen to look up and see them, you too stand in awe of the one who created them, the one who gave to them to shine to His glory. We as God's people reflect Jesus' light by receiving it and then directing it out to shine on others, holding out also to them His word of life. In the name of Jesus, amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds faithful in Christ until life everlasting. Amen. Together as God's people, we confess our faith. Today we use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As you're well aware, this time in the service, if if we were in normal conditions and if we were all meeting together in the sanctuary, this would be the time for receiving of the offerings, where we put into the offering plate our gifts, our tithes, our offerings for the Lord to do His work here in this place and even beyond. And we just today want to say thank you. We pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we can only marvel at your great humility for leaving your throne in heaven to walk the way of the cross as our substitute. We know we could never enter heaven on the basis of our own merit, for we have sinned and come far short of the glory of God. But we know your grace, dear Savior, that though you were rich, yet for our sakes you became poor, so that we, through your poverty, might become rich. Through you, we have full forgiveness. Through you alone, we are graciously made fit in every way for heaven. Oh, let us never fail to appreciate and trust all that you did to redeem us from our sins and reconcile us to God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, by prayerful meditation upon your cross, your bitter suffering and death for us, may we grow more mature in our faith and our love for you, and at the same time learn to love all people. Give us ready hearts to believe whatever you say and obey whatever you command. To this end, send your Holy Spirit with his grace to dwell in us richly and to work in us powerfully. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We also praise you as our exalted Lord and Savior for having gotten us the victory over death and the devil, over sin and hell. You rose again from the dead and are now glorified at the right hand of God in heaven. Cast away from us all doubt and draw us continually closer to you. Use us as your witnesses to proclaim your saving name to others. Wash away our sins in the blood that you shed for every sinner. Watch over us day by day, protecting us from all danger, guarding and keeping us from every evil that threatens our bodies and souls. In your mercy, attend to our many physical needs, especially the needs of each one listed by name on our connection pages and those that we name before you right now in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask this all to the glory of your precious name, before which every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Hear us, Lord Jesus. Amen. Together we pray our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. With open ears and hands and hearts, receive the benediction of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.